from the heart of America in Chicago, Illinois.
It's time for Roker Radio with Al Roker Jr. And now, Al Roker Jr.
How you doing, everybody? Welcome to another edition of Roker Radio. Al Roker Jr., pop-up edition, Degenerates Assemble, Super Bowl week, Super Bowl 55. It's the week we've all been waiting for. Dana with me as usual, and host of Gutting the Sacred Cow, comedian Kevin Gootee. How you doing, brothers?
Hey-o! What's a good word, fellas?
How's it going? Finally, we finally made it. Finally made it to the big game, huh?
You know it.
Before we start talking about this week's game, how did you like this football season? Did you think that the season was going to go off pretty much without a hitch? Did you like some of the adjustments that they made? We ended up having 1 week of the season where we had a game on every day of the week because of COVID. Do you think that everything pretty well went well in this 101st NFL season?
I think they did a great job calling shit on the fly. They were really cool. And I thought that this season overall, my worst betting season in three or four years by far.
I agree.
Last year, year before that, it was over 60%. This year is 53. And I was 0-5! 0-5! Championship weekend. Bad one. Bad one. But I did. I tell you what, my favorite part of this year was having football on every day of the week. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, obviously. That was really cool. Like, just random days going, oh, it's Tuesday night. Got a fucking game. This is awesome. You know, I mean, no baseball for me. So that's that was a nice bonus. So, and they did a great job, like I said, of calling things happening on the fly. The only team that really got fucked were the Bills, not knowing who they would play that one weekend with Tennessee. But I think the NFL should really take a bow and did a great job of getting things going and no missed time to get everything off in the exact time frame for the Super Bowl without missing a beat. Great job. So take a bow, Goodell and company.
Yeah, I agree. I didn't think that the Super Bowl would have been still on track as it always is, you know, in February. I thought it would have been pushed back or something would have been delayed. And we had a couple threats throughout the towards the end of the season where, you know, Pittsburgh started getting a couple of the cases. A lot of the players started just falling apart. But for the most part, the NFL kind of wrangled it in. And like Kevin said, I think that having a football game on a Tuesday and a Wednesday and then back to Thursday, Friday, Saturday, yeah, it spiced it up. I wouldn't mind having this in a regular year, too.
Well, here in Illinois, you had the sports betting remotely kind of kick in right around the same time. You had the baseball season start, and then you had baseball going playoffs, hockey playoffs, basketball bubble, then football season started. It was all like right at the same time. It was, I mean, you couldn't ask for anything more if you're a degenerate and you were able to get on it in Illinois or Indiana where these, you know, where the sports betting had just become legal. It was incredible. And speaking of COVID, I want to know your opinion on this. And this could have been so much worse. It looks like it's not going to affect anybody. But the barber for the Chiefs ends up catching COVID. And he had a whole bunch of clients on the docket for that day, including Patrick Mahomes. Now, it only turns out that he only ended up cutting a couple of people's hair, and if they test positive for like 5 days, they're going to be able to play. But it could have been much, much worse. But, Dano, you know this. I've been talking about this ever since COVID began. It always pissed me off when people were going, I got to go get my hair did. I got to go to the hairdresser. I got to get this. I got to do this. I got to do that. Look, it's Super Bowl week. You don't need to get your hair cut. And whoever this barber is, whoever was in charge of, I don't know if this was their team barber and he was on the facility or was a barber they brought in, whoever was in charge of that, that guy needs to be fired. this entire team should have been on 100% lockdown for 2 weeks, period. You go all this way, you go through all of this to have a freaking barber catch COVID the week before the Super Bowl and possibly infect 20 people on your team? That's when you should be getting out the flaming lips, Wang Kung bubbles, and just having people in them for two straight weeks.
You know, this is a special day because I never thought I'd hear a black guy make a flaming lips reference ever.
I am a special kind of black guy.
I'll go on the internet today.
Don't get him started on Rush.
But when I heard about that barber, I'm going, how can you let this happen? How are you not?
Well, it was also fantastic. Did you hear that? Like, literally, as they got his test in, they found out he's guilty. And I think the offensive lineman's like, oh, don't worry about it. Just finish my haircut. And then DeMarcus Robinson also got his haircut. And I'm glad because that dude's fast as shit. So what's the ruling? Is he out for the game just because of protocol?
It looks like he can go.
They're still available. They can still go for it. The test, again, negative, but. It's within 5 days, so.
Yes, it looks like they're going to be good to go. But it could have been, boy, can you imagine if Mahomes had ended up on the COVID list?
All my bets would have been through the roof.
Mine too.
How are you guys going to be spending this special Super Bowl Sunday? What are you going to be? Where are you going to watch it? Who are you watching it with?
I have with my two buddies. It's always us two and sometimes more. But for the last 20-some years, it's at one of their two homes. And I just go down there because they live 15, 20 minutes from each other down the shore in Jersey. And I text him just the other day. Hey, is this happening?
You still on?
Yep, it's happening.
Good.
So we're going down there. I guess everyone's going to be as safe and clear and we'll see. So actually, I'll talk about that later off the air. But yeah, so yeah, that's my story.
Dano, you're going to be giving that brand new television set a workout?
Yeah, we're going to test it out, make sure everything works. Going to make sure my sling doesn't start stuttering on me. And I'm excited. I'm just going to probably do it at home, order a bunch of shitty food. Just, you know, I didn't have the best football season in terms of betting, like Kevin. I don't know. Outside of week two, where KC saved my ass and I won a ton of money.
Week three, the Chargers. I had that game too. I was in Vegas. Yeah. Dude, I went over. I teased that down to like -2 and he hit me with a 57-yarder. Oh, that was a beautiful day. 3-1 that day in Vegas.
Talk about a fucking heart attack. So on FanDuel, I'm new to FanDuel. Roke just turned me on. We got the reward credit for referring someone. And I literally put in those bets. It was my first week betting on football, and I won over $1,000 because of that comeback. And FanDuel's like, do you want to cash out? And it went from like 1,000 to like 200 when they were getting their asses whooped. And then it started trickling back up, and then he won. But then week three on, like I told Ro a couple weeks ago, I'm just getting my ass handed to me in football with like the dumbest shit happening every week. So I don't know. I got a couple parlays alive. And I'm really looking forward to Sunday to recouping some of that bullshit I lost throughout the year.
Yeah. I'm going to be sitting here. I got my chicken wings ready. Got frozen pizzas. It's going to be a
frozen pizza. What the fuck is wrong with you, dude? You live in the second best towns, apparently, supposedly for pizza. Yet you're going to get frozen pizzas? Order in like a regular spot in your neighborhood, bro.
Well, the problem is the spot in my neighborhood has gone downhill. They moved. And I don't know if their ovens aren't seasoned right. They got new ovens or something. And their pizza just hasn't tasted right lately. And my problem is if I buy an entire, like, pizza, I'm going to eat an entire pizza. So at least if I just go with a frozen pizza, at least I'm eating probably 2/3 less than I would have actually had I gone out and bought, you know, some Home Run In or some Pequods or something like that. So I'm okay. I'm okay with it. I'm, you know, my wife's a good cook. She'll doctor it up.
Nah, stop your bullshit, Rook. One thing Kevin doesn't know is Claire's going to spoil the fuck out of you. You're going to have your two frozen pizzas. Then you're going to have a shrimp plate or a fucking tower. You're going to have some oysters that you flew in from New Orleans and shit like that. It's not like two frozen pizzas like you're thinking, Kevin. It's a smorgasbord of shit that he's going to have.
Yeah, it's going to be, it'll be an epic day. It'll be
maybe
an epic
can
day.
You make some homemade bagels with some salmon and cream cheese?
We went to the store today to beat the storm to make sure we had stuff. And when I say we, I mean shit.
Is it supposed to hit? You guys can get snow or something?
Yo, we're getting snow as we speak, and then we're going to be in the deep freeze.
We're
going to have.
We might have gotten snow on Sunday, but I don't. It's not. It's actually 45 and melting shit here nicely. So it's. Really. Maybe I'm not going to my buddy's house. Maybe my wife should stock up as well. Yeah. We have a party.
Man, keep an eye on it. It's supposed to be brutal.
Yeah, we're not supposed to go above 10 degrees for like the next till like Tuesday after today.
Oh God damn it! 60% chance of snow on Sunday here.
Yeah,
that's great.
Yeah, keep an eye on it. They don't know what they're talking about.
Yeah.
All right.
I did the same thing on Monday. We got a foot and a half. So
Exactly. You got hit by the same snowstorm that we got hit by. Yeah, that's exactly right. All right, so we're going to talk about prop bets, and we're going to talk about the game. If you want to know about how to bet, you know, office pools and squares and strip cards and things of that nature, check out the last episode of Roker Radio if you're doing the office pool. But right now we're going to talk about prop bets. I don't know if you have one prop bet that you like or if you have a couple that you're going over, but let's start with the host of Gutting the Sacred Cow, coming to us all the way from the East Coast. It's Mr. Kevin Gootee. Prop bets, sir.
Prop bets. Well, I have a ton.
I thought you might.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I have 6 booked, and I'm looking to four more. Two I can book. Two I'm waiting to find. The one I love, and it doesn't miss, and I can't find it on FanDuel. If you guys found it, I need to know about it now. But I'll tell you what I've booked already, and that's the third quarter to outscore the first quarter. And that's -150. They always start off slow. Everyone gets conservative, trying to feel their pants out in the first quarter. They're always conservative. The third quarter is where they take their pants off and get comfortable. And they start airing it out and shit happens. I.e. see the Super Bowl from, was it 03? Carolina fucking Patriots. Guess who had the under? You know what that score was at the half? 0-0.
Yeah.
What happened? 60 fucking points and I lose. So the second half alone is actually that's the bet I'm looking to book, is second half outscoring the first, which I can't find on FanDuel. So if you guys can find that, that'd be great. But I already booked third quarter outscoring the first quarter. Love it.
And you also like second half to outscore the first half?
No, doesn't miss. It does not miss.
And by the way, I based all my – the ones that I'm betting – I based all those on FanDuel because there are a million of them, but there are only so many on FanDuel. So, okay. So let's see. First half. I'm writing this down. Got a whole sheet of paper to write down your stuff with because I've been writing stuff down on envelopes and stuff like that and can't read my handwriting. So Kevin loves third quarter to outscore the first quarter as a prop, second half to outscore the first half. Dano, what do you like prop bet wise?
I'm looking at FanDuel and I'm kind of really intrigued. It's probably going to be, well, first is the Gatorade. Who's going to, what color Gatorade is going to be? And purple for some reason is like +1,000. So we'll see about that. I'm assuming it might be the red/pink one. So I'm tempted to do something stupid with just like with a long shot.
Just for fun?
I found two that I really like. And it's similar to what Kevin's talking about the second half. But these odds are ridiculously good. Brady to throw a +120.
You broke up there for a second.
A touchdown.
You broke up there for a second. Oh. Brady to do what?
To throw a touchdown in the third quarter is +120. And Brady to throw a touchdown in the fourth quarter is +105. Am I crazy to take both of those?
Down right now.
No, those are, I like that. I didn't see those.
In fact, just adding all this shit to my bet slip. What's it under? Is it under scoring or is it under player QB props?
Actually, I didn't even go to the TV props. It's so if you
It's under QB props.
Oh, it's, under QB. Yeah, there you go.
So Dano likes Brady to throw a touchdown in the third quarter, getting a $120, and to throw one in the fourth quarter, plus 105.
Yeah.
Interesting. Okay, here's what I have. And do you have any more, Dano?
No, I'm still looking at some of these because now that Kevin asked me to look at some of the things, I didn't see the scroller with all the
I'll roll mine out, and if you guys have any others that you want to toss in here, you can toss them in. I like, is there going to be a roughing the passer? Yes.
You
yes.
Motherfucker, I have that on my list too.
Yes is a plus 155. These are going to be two of the most protected quarterbacks in the history of the game. If they get scratched with a fingernail, you're going to get a roughing the passer. I love that one. Kev loves that one too.
I love that because one of the gambling podcasts I listen to, they always say, take no. I go, no, when Brady is at home, and if they, we all saw that last second with the last second flag with the offside or the holding, defensive holding.
Right.
Dude, you're 100% right. They will totally, if it's a half a second after he throws that ball and someone hits him, flags coming in. I put a little on it. I go crazy, but I saw that go, nah, this is going to happen with Brady, the big pussy that he is. He's going to cry and they will throw one flag for sure.
And I would even guess that it would happen in the first quarter to set the precedent. Don't get close to these quarterbacks. Another one is same type of vein. Quarterback to be sacked first. And I'm getting Brady plus 100 because if you've watched him this season, especially when people get near him, when he's going to get sacked, he pulls a Brett Favre, Michael Strahan. He basically just goes down so that he doesn't get hit. So I like Brady getting sacked first plus 100.
Even money.
And then the stat that has just blown my mind this entire week is that Tom Brady has been in 9 Super Bowls and has had 0 touchdown drives in the first quarter in 9 Super Bowls. None. The most points that a Brady-led team has ever come away with in the first quarter in 9 Super Bowls is 3 points. The highest scoring quarter of a Super Bowl in which Brady was involved was 52, Super Bowl 52, where the Eagles led 9-3 at the end of the first quarter. Brady teams have never had a first quarter touchdown drive in 9 straight Super Bowls, and in 5 of them, the score at the end of the first quarter was 0-0.
Oh, yeah.
So I am going with lowest scoring quarter, first quarter, getting plus 210. I'm also putting money on first quarter draw, plus 400.
Wow. I don't know about that.
Well, in 5 of the games, Super Bowls you've been in, it's been 0-0 after the first quarter. You're telling me there's not a chance it's going to be 0-0, 3-3, or 7-7 at the end of one?
No,
I'm saying for plus 400, I'll take that bet. And then I'm also taking first quarter spread, Kansas City half a point, I'm getting plus 106.
Look at what happened with Green Bay. They took the ball. They went right down the field. And this is going to tie in my next one. If I can find this, I can't find it on FanDuel, but they talked about another podcast. Tampa Bay to receive. So if they win the coin toss, they're going to receive. Because what's going to happen, Mahomes always, they always defer. And Tampa's going to take that ball first because the last thing they want to do is get down to Tampa, so KC at any point. So I think they're going to go right down the field if possible and score. So I don't think it's going to be 0-0. If anything, they're going to go kick a field goal at the worst. But I think Tampa's going to come out. They get that ball. They are going to put points on the board. That is my thing. So I disagree on the 0-0, but I think – well, fuck it. I'll tie it.
Well, it's not – I'm not saying it's going to be 0-0. I'm saying it's going to be – it's going to be a draw. I'm saying I'm getting plus 400 for a draw. So I'll take that. And I'm taking lowest scoring quarter being the first quarter as well. Just based upon – I cannot ignore – these first quarter scores in these Brady Super Bowl, I can't ignore 3-0, 0-0, 0-0, 3-0, 9-0, 0-0, 0-0, 9-3, 0-0. I can't ignore it. If it doesn't happen,
maybe you should ignore that and bet the opposite. Because when I see 10 black on a roulette wheel thing, I go to bet red on that motherfucker.
And then it comes up black, and you go, I should have bet black. Always bet on black.
And I
Wesley
double
Snipes
or nothing the next one.
Well, yeah, there you go. Until you get it. Until you get it.
Yep.
So
what's your other one, Kevin?
Well, you kind of tied into another one. I don't know which way I'm going to go first. We talk about the roughing the passer. I'll have that. Since you kind of talk, I'll dovetail into this one. Under 11.5 penalties. They are not throwing the flags unless it is absolutely blatant. And if you look at other Super Bowls, they do not – look at the championship game. Shit. Unless it's a false start, no one's getting called or an offsides. That's it. Under 11.5 penalties hits a lot. I hit it last year. I'm hitting it again.
They have been been holding on to the flag. They held on to the flag for about an extra 5 seconds on that pass interference call in the championship game. Which made it seem a little suspect, but it was the right call. But yes, they definitely been holding on to the Hankies so far this year. People want to see him play. Okay, so let me get the recap here, and we'll go over this again at the end. Kev likes third quarter to outscore the first quarter, or second half to outscore the first half, under 11.5 penalties. Dano likes Brady to throw a touchdown in the third, Brady to throw a touchdown in the fourth. I like roughing the passer, yes. I like lowest scoring quarter, first quarter. And I'm also going with a draw in the first quarter for plus 400.
Now, lowest first quarter, I like that. I'm going to add that too. Lowest scoring first quarter, that's a good
lowest,
one.
Lowest
I got another one for you guys.
All right.
I got one last one. It's the jersey number of the first touchdown and the last touchdown. It's two separate prop bets. So the jersey number of the first touchdown, will it be over or under 22.5? So I'm assuming it's going to be a receiver or some sort of running back with a number at 23 or higher. So I like that. That's that little bit. Props bet.
Wait
it's
a minute.
A little degenerate prop
That's
bet.
A super degenerate prop bet. Say that one. Say that one again. First and last. Say it again.
So it's what is the jersey number of the person who gets the first touchdown and the last touchdown of the game? They're two separate props. Will the number be higher or lower than 22.5? So like Kelsey's what? Number 87. So he would be the over. But Tyreek Hill, I think, is what, like number 18 or some shit?
So which are you taking, higher or lower?
10.
So I want to do the over.
You're taking the higher.
I think a lot of the, like to Kevin's point, I think Tampa Bay's getting the ball. It's they're going to be at home, and they're going to be cruising through the field. So if they get the first touchdown, Gronk and most of those guys have higher numbers too.
Back up one sec. Where did you find that lowest quarter, lowest scoring quarter prop? What's that under? Because I'm looking right now still, and I can't find that.
Let's see if I can find it. Let me see if I can find it on my phone here real quick.
Oh, Kev, it's under football, Super Bowl props, under points. It's right after touchdown and scoring. If you scroll where you saw the QB props, receiver props, scroll on that little thing to points.
I was there, and it says –
Lowest scoring quarter. It's the third one.
It says combined points. It doesn't give me the quarters, though.
Oh, Rogue, did you find something different?
No, because I based all mine off of what was on FanDuel. Which one are you looking for again? Lowest scoring quarter? Lowest
scoring quarter.
If you go to... Now, you know what? It was I was finding more on my desktop than I was on FanDuel on my desktop than I was finding on my phone.
Huh. Okay.
So I would start there. Let's see. Because there was a one that was also broke it down into specific quarters. Let's see here. Come on. First quarter. So go into...
Are you in the app or in the desktop?
Right now I'm in the app. We'll have to look for it. We'll have to look for it a little bit later, but it was there. It takes a little bit to find it though. But if you can find that, I would go on it. All right, so the game itself, fellas, Super Bowl.
Oh, I have a few more props.
Oh, you got a few more props, please. Flip my page back over. Get my pen out.
Shortest touchdown, under 1.5 yards. Love it. Because what's going to happen? Deep ball, pass interference, boom. At the one, someone's going to march it in from the one. Love under 1.5 as the shortest touchdown scored.
Loves it. Under 1.5, shortest TD.
Yep, I have that.
Anything else?
And as a real degenerate.
Ah, here's his degenerate one.
I always take tails. Tails never fails, boys. Tails it is. Got the tails. So that's minus 103 for 100, which, again, those damn bookies. I have Travis Kelce anytime touchdown score. They juiced the shit out of this. It's like minus 165.
Yeah. We saw it at minus 170 a few days ago.
Yeah. So those are the other ones I have as well. So tails, shortest touchdown under 1.5 yards.
I'll give you one super degenerate prop, and that is National Anthem.
That's the other one I love. So who's singing it?
They're usually the national anthems are the bet is will it be over or under 2 minutes. Now, ever since Whitney Houston's national anthem in Super Bowl 25 during the Gulf War, the national anthem has averaged...
Oh, you mean the one where the Giants won the Super Bowl?
That's a wide right. Yes, that's exactly right.
I remember that one, kind of, sort of.
The national anthem has averaged just a little over 1:56. Although 5 of the last 6 have gone over 2 minutes, and this year it is a duet. And I can't remember who the two people are. If Dano, you can look it up real quick. I had it for my other radio show, but I don't have those notes with me. But it's a duet, which means that both singers are going to have their little moment in the spotlight. And all that moment in the spotlight takes is an extra 5 or 7 seconds apiece, whether or not it's a little guitar solo or holding a note or something like that. So I would take over 2 minutes on the national anthem for this year.
Roke, I actually won it a few years back when Christina Aguilera did it, because I YouTubed her doing the national anthem like in the past. And I saw that every video was over that number. So
nice.
I bet the over, and she let it ring out. But it's Eric Church and Jasmine Sullivan.
Yes.
All right. I have an important question.
And Jasmine Sullivan's like a black chick, right? I'm just saying, before you come outside with the tiki torches, that means she's got some church in her. And not, I don't mean Eric Church, but that means she's gonna get her sing on. If only for a moment, she's gonna get her sing on, which means it's gonna go long.
Is that even an option here on FanDuel?
I don't think it's. I don't know. It's. I haven't seen it on FanDuel, but there are other places where you can do it. And of course, if you're going to end up being in Vegas or being actually, you know, at a book, you know, maybe you're going to go over to the Horseshoe in Hammond or something and bet it. It'll be there.
National Anthem. Hey, Rook, so what is it at right now? What's the total time?
Usually it's 2 minutes. Usually it's 2 minutes.
Check this out. So I did a quick search, and the first two videos on YouTube are Jasmine Sullivan from 6 years ago and 4 years ago. The first one is 2 minutes and 13 seconds, and then the second one's 2 minutes and 9 seconds.
Yeah, right. There you go.
I'll do you better. Here's my rule of thumb. White singer, under. Black singer, over. Because they get in that shit like Al said. Because I had it a year or two. When did Lady Gaga sing it? Well, she, first of all, again, she's quick. Then I heard she had the flu. And I go, she's not out there trying to be a fucking hero. She's going to get this shit and be done with it. And boy, oh boy, it was the drive through, and I made that shit without even thinking. So if it's a black girl singing, we're on the over on this one, fellas.
Listen, the brothers and the sisters, they invented that shit. Google Marvin Gaye at the 82 NBA All-Star Game. He invented this. Well, Jose Feliciano invented this shit at the World Series in like 1971. But as far as the singing of the national anthem going on forever and ever and ever, that was a Marvin Gaye thing. He started it, and now everyone wants their little piece of the pie like the Jeffersons. You were going to say, Dano?
Last prop bet for you guys.
Yes.
Since you guys are raving about the third quarter. They have these things where it's like, which quarter will have more points? The second quarter or versus the third quarter? If you think that the third quarter will have more points than the second, it's plus 185. Third quarter
third
over
more
the second
than,
quarter.
Third quarter, more points than second quarter.
It's plus 185, but if you think the second quarter will score more points, it's minus 240. Oof. So Kev said a good point, which usually the teams come out, and like we've argued in the past, Tom Brady doesn't start really scoring until the second half.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so he played the Green Bay Packers 2 weeks ago and came out fucking firing, so whoops.
On a few. He knew he needed points in that game.
And, you know,
plus Green Bay took that lead, though.
And the question is, you know, is this a Brady thing? This is like me going back to the fact that he's never had a touchdown drive in the first quarter. Is this a Brady thing, or is this a Belichick first 15 plays scripted thing? I guess we'll find out on Sunday. But again, I can't ignore that trend. All right. The prop bets are fun. Kevin Gootee emailed me 2 weeks ago and told me this. I just placed my biggest bet of the year 5 minutes after the game ended on Sunday. What a tease. What a tease.
Really? What?
That's how I fucking do this, baby.
So
that's how Gutting the Sacred Cows becomes a huge podcast. I know how this game is run.
So I have been on pins and needles, and not just because I'm diabetic. I have been on pins and needles now for almost 2 weeks to hear what Kevin Gootee has bet on. Super Bowl LV 55. What you got, brother?
I watched the game as we all did. And after watching the games, I immediately went out and put $2,000 on the money line for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
Wow.
They went out to Green Bay and they did it. And I forgot a few things. That defense is damn good. All right.
What did I say?
The defense is amazing. All right. Listen, and what really fucked it up, and I knew it going into that game, and I knew Bakhtiari was out, but I didn't know how much of an impact him being out would be. Now that the fucking Eric Fisher is out, he was out, he blew his knee out in that AFC Championship game. Jeff Schwartz, the right tackle, or is it Mitchell Schwartz? One of those fucking Schwartz guys. The right tackle is out too. You mean to tell me that
the Schwartz will not be
line,
with them?
Listen, and Mahomes is great. Mahomes can no one can dance around better than Mahomes. We know that. So it's good. If this was somebody else, if this is any other quarterback, this is the death knell. But Mahomes at least has a fighting chance. But you mean and Brady? Rodgers, pretty darn mobile. Not Patrick Mahomes mobile, but mobile nonetheless. We saw what that Tampa Bay linebacking core did to that Green Bay fucking offensive line. They went out there and butt raped them on the 50-yard line for 60 fucking minutes straight. They also have the number one rush defense in the game. Who is their best running back? Edwards-Helaire, he's banged up. Who's next on the list? Le'Veon Bell, he stinks this year. So we all know, and it's virtually unstoppable so far, it's the Kelce and the Tyreek Hill show with maybe a dash of Mecole Hardman sprinkled in there. But I think, more importantly, does this NFL first Super Bowl for the NFL at home play a role? Bet your ass it does, even though it's only 25% filled the capacity, but you know what? They're all Bucs fans. They're all Tampa Bay local workers. Now, is that much of a point? I think it's at least a point or thereabouts when you consider a handicap. And let's also add no distractions for the Bucs. They're at home. They don't have to go get on a plane and go through the whole rigmarole. That is huge. And you don't think the NFL wants the worst way for the narrative to be Tom Brady wins without Bill Belichick? Get the fuck out of here. They have them. The offensive line is banged up. That defense is flying. And they have more weapons on offense with Tampa Bay than Kansas City does. Now, Kansas City has two absolute out-of-this-world studs. Tom Brady's been there 9 times, to quote Edward R. Rooney, Dean of Students in Ferris Bueller's Day Off in your hometown of Chicago. 9 times. This is number 10. Anyone knows how to do it, it's him. They're going to do what the Giants did back in the last Super Bowls against the Patriots, and that's run the ball down their fucking throats and play defense. Keep the ball out of Mahomes' hand. Have the Giants beat the Bills? I'll tell you. 41 minutes of time of possession. That's exactly what Parcells told all the linemen. Don't you dare snap that ball until that play clock says 2 seconds. You kick the ball around, you fuck around. That's what they're going to do. They're going to keep the ball out of the hands of the Chiefs. And I even had, I think I wrote this down too, I'm very much considering also as a prop taking under the first half under 28.5 for that very reason. So I say the fuck the 3 or 3. It's now 3.5. I think the Bucs went outright, and because of that, I said, you know what? Heidi-ho on the money line, Bucs plus 145. $2,000 to win $29.60 if this thing comes home.
That's
bang.
And what was the first half under?
By the way, the Chiefs are 1-5 straight up playing the Bucs. Now, again, to be fair, is that all against Brady versus Mahomes? No, it's not. It's only one game. But you mean to tell me take out the one win they had this year? Fucking Jameis Winston beat them previously. I don't know if the Chiefs and Bucks played before that. I probably should look that up. But that's the only stat that, a lot of these stats you got to throw away that I get from Odd Shark. But that's the one number I go, well, that's interesting. Is that number 1-5 against straight up against Tampa Bay?
They only beat them 27-24.
What's that?
And they only beat them 27-24. They had like a 3-touchdown lead and then they blew it. And that was in Kansas City. So Tampa's got it in the bag.
But don't forget, Kansas City kept the ball out of their hands. They had the ball for 4 minutes to close that game out, which is pretty good. But I think the narrative here is A, Brady, B, at home with the refs in the back pocket, as we all know. But most importantly is C, the offensive line for the Chiefs average at best now down 2 tackles, 2 bookends. That's fucking huge, especially with JPP and Shaq Barrett. And Sue and those guys coming at him. I like the Bucs. I threw it out there 5 minutes after that game ended. So what does that tell you? Bucs money line. That's the play.
Bucs money line. And you also said you liked the first half under, which was what?
28.5.
All right. Well, we have a vague idea of where Kevin stands. Dana, what about you?
Do you guys even want to question where my allegiance stands?
I think I know where your allegiance stands because I've been getting texts from you for two straight freaking weeks.
I'm sorry to jump in before. I got one other point I want to make why this is going to hit. You ready?
Yeah.
One of my buddies who was shower, he's a comic buddy of mine, shower name nameless. He does a thing where it's called his lock of the week every week. He picks one game with a stale line, mind you, a stale line. And every year, he is below 50%. When he saw I posted this on Facebook, he called me the next day, Monday, and said, you love the Bucks? Yes, I do. How about we bet a steak dinner on it? I'll take the Chiefs. I have friends who fucking follow me and go, holy shit. And I called a few of them and go, holy shit, dude. He called me. He put a steak dinner on. This guy is a mush. Every week, we fade him a lot. A lot. The guy never takes a rarely takes a dog. And he goes, steak dinner, I'll take the Chiefs minus three. You take the Bucks plus three. I go, fucking done and done. So the mush of all mushes is on the Chiefs. Let that be out there to you guys as well.
Rook is so sad.
That guy's like, he's like the guy from a Bronx Tale, right? Every time they're around him, he fucking loses, right?
Bobby cakes.
Well, my recommendation for you, Kevin, would be the bone-in ribeye. Never.
That's the only thing I get.
Never
that is
fails.
The only thing I get, a bone and ribeye.
Never fails.
Well, everything that Kev said, I agree. I've been calling it from week number one. I mean, listen, this is a quarterback that's a legend in its own right, but he just won three games on the road in a row, back to back to back. And what I tell you weeks ago, Roke, whoever gets past Green Bay will win the Super Bowl. If it's not Green Bay themselves. And I'm going to continue with that trend and add a D to Kevin's first 3 points. D is 22,000 fans in Florida. That's what they're calculating they're going to allow. 22,000 fans when you're used to just a couple hundred, if any, fans throughout the rest of the season or earlier in the season. Right. It's going to be a torrential downpour for fucking Mahomes and that offense and trying to communicate, especially with two new linemen guys or offensive linemen.
I was going to ask you guys if you thought that the home field advantage would mean anything. What'd you say, Kev?
I said I'm looking at the weather right now. 60% chance of thunderstorms, which definitely plays right into the hands of Tampa Bay with that ground and pound and the defense they have. That's big right there.
Yeah. Fournette's from Jacksonville area, or he ran for them, so he's used to that little bit of mush running.
I forgot to mention that the game is that Kansas City is a 3-point favorite. The over-under had dropped to 55.5 for a minute yesterday, but it's basically the over-under is at 56 across the board. Okay, well, I had all this little statistic stuff that I was going to run down for you.
Let's hear it.
But I'll just say this. I've got a futures bet that I'm getting plus 600 on Kansas City beating Tampa Bay. So
better hedge it.
I want that. I am going to hedge it. I'm going to hedge it. I would like for that to hit. I mean, these teams are so ridiculously even. I was like staring at this legal pad last night, it's, they're so freaking even. KC, 415 yards a game. Tampa Bay, 384 yards a game. Kansas City, 29.6 points a game. Tampa, 30.8 points a game. Kansas City, 22.6 points allowed per game. Tampa Bay, 22.2 points allowed per game. Now, in that game versus Green Bay, and kudos to Tampa Bay for winning that game. But Green Bay played about the worst game I've seen them play in years. Brady throws three interceptions and they still win that game. They got 7 points off of turnovers. That's Chicago Bear-esque what Green Bay did in that game. 7 points off of turnovers. A shit poor coaching decision by kicking the field goal with 2 minutes and 5 seconds to go in the game when you still needed to get another score. So you had bad coaching. You had an inexcusable touchdown that they gave up at the end of the half, Green Bay, which ended up being the difference in the game. So, yes, there's two ways you can look at it. It's glass half empty, glass half full. You can look at it as Tampa Bay's so good, they had three, Tom Brady gave up three interceptions and they still won that game. Or you can look at it as Green Bay lost that game more so than they got only 7 points off of turnovers. They shouldn't have kicked that field goal with 2.5 minutes left in the game. The touchdown at the end of the half was a killer. Touchdown at the end of the half, turnover to begin the half, then they get another touchdown, so that's 14 points, and now they're all of a sudden they're down, what were they, into, like down something like 24-10 or something? Like in,
yeah.
Yeah. I mean, none of that should have happened. So, meanwhile, KC played their best game of the year against the Bills. Played their best game of the year against the Bills. They were down 9-0 at the end of the first half and then outscored them 38-15 the rest of the way. And Mahomes was questionable for that game. And he had the lingering turf toe. And that was 2 weeks ago. I'm taking KC in the money line.
Ah, afraid to lay the three, are you?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. So what do you say then about the pass rush and then the fucking offensive line of Green Bay getting eaten alive? Because that's the same boat Kansas City's in right now.
That shit out of Rodgers all day long.
That's true, but that's Aaron Rodgers. That's not Patrick Mahomes. Let me say something real quick. Let me say something. And I'm not, and believe me, I'm not one of these, Chris Collinsworth, Patrick Mahomes is the second coming of Jesus type guy. I'm far from it. But the things that he has been able to do, I don't know if he's just so young that he just doesn't know any better yet or what, but he does seem to be able to get himself out of situations that most quarterbacks can't. I don't know how many times I've thought, oh, I've got this under with Kansas City, and then they put up 28 points in the last 20 minutes of the game. Or just like last week, they got nothing going into the second quarter, and then boom, they scored 38. They put up points like that. They put up points like that. It's again, if I didn't have that plus 600 futures bet on KC, I would probably be taking Tampa Bay in the points.
Brooke, what's your futures bet? How much is it?
It was plus 600. Let's not get into that. It's a little less than what Kevin put down on the game. It's a little less than what Kevin put down on the game. What'd you say?
You could hedge your bet is what I'm getting at. Yeah. What would you say, Kev?
I said if he says he has like a $50 bet on this, I'm going to throw his baseball through the fucking computer.
Brooke, why don't you answer that question?
I can't remember. My phone's in the other room.
Liar.
Yeah. So speaking of your hedge or your Fortune 500 bet that you did, I called the Tampa Bay Buccaneers to win the Super Bowl outright on January 9th at plus 750. Then I followed it up after right before the Green Bay game on January 17th plus 1,000. And then I put Tampa Bay to beat Kansas City exact result plus 1,700. Wow. And then I also took them in a parlay where they're going to win by 14 points or more, plus 700.
So you don't even think it's going to be close.
Dude, Tampa Bay's going to whoop their ass at home. That's what's up.
I will say this. If the Chiefs didn't win last year, this is a no-brainer. But they got the fucking proverbial monkey off their back. And they've got like, all right, Andy Reid's got a Super Bowl. If he retired, if he fucking dropped out of a heart attack last year, February 5th, he's going to the Hall of Fame.
Right.
Now, there is, and Patrick Mahomes is what, 23, 24?
23.
He's going to be back here a long time. Yeah. If they, I don't think the sense of urgency is near what it was last year. They're going to want to win, obviously, but I don't think that they've got that near fire in their asshole to win at all fucking costs. Like, they're going to do their damnedest, but it's not going to be as much as it was last year, I think.
And you know who does?
Tom Brady.
Fuck you, Belichick. That's what's going to be going on. Yeah. Not to mention, every article I'm reading, this dude's totally calming the whole locker room. Everybody's talking about how he's coming in, calming everybody's nerves, telling them to shut the fuck up. There's one more game before they start crying or celebrating. And he's being a fucking positive like reinforcement in that locker room. Him and Gronkowski have the experience, and they're making everybody have a good time, and they're going to enjoy it.
And JPP.
Yeah. Yeah, and man, not to mention that dude and Sue on defense, they're going to terrorize that front line. I mean, I called it from week one, and I had an uphill battle against you guys. You guys were choosing against Tampa Bay, and I got it, man. It was away games. It was in the cold. You know, you got a bunch of Tampa Bay Bucks that are used to playing in the warmth. They had an uphill battle, but what was it? Every game, I think that they were underdogs, right?
No. They played the Redskins game one. That's not an underdog.
Okay, they were a few points. Okay.
Yeah, but at the same time, that's the road warrior mentality yet again that my New York Football Giants fucking have. You catch fire at the right time, that's the way to go in. And they went out, they handled the Bucs. They didn't blow them out like I thought they were gonna the Bucs, but they should have. They got their shit straight. And I think it even came together nicely for them. That's for sure.
Well, that's it's interesting because just looking at my notes here, it looks like you took the Saints in the money line, Kev, and then you had the Packers.
Yeah, I teased them down.
but
I still lost.
But you've become a fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, we won't get fooled again. So you are a convert.
That was 4 years, 4 years fucking straight of betting on Drew Brees at home. And I got burned four straight years in the NFC Championship or NFC playoffs. So
at least you won't get burned a fifth time.
I know, right? You're not kidding. But yeah, I've seen enough. And again, the only time I don't bet against Tom Brady is when he's playing the New York Football Giants. I made money on that twice. And the only time I lost money betting against him, the fucking Eagles game, because my hatred for that shitbox town. I still can't believe they won that Super Bowl. So, yeah, I don't make money betting against Tom Brady in the big game unless he's playing my Giants. So, let's roll.
Let me ask you this final question, and we'll wrap this up. Do you think as we get closer to game time, do you think that this number may move at all? Because you're going to end up getting late money on Brady for all the reasons that you just mentioned? Because you know that all the public watching the pregame for 8 hours before the game, they're all going to be talking about Tom Brady this, Tom Brady that, Tom Brady this, Tom Brady that. And all that late money is going to come in on the Bucs.
I think it's going to come in for a couple of reasons, because it's what, some places I'm seeing 3.5. So people are going to take that extra hook and run with it. Second of all, if it rains, as Dano had said a few times, that, again, that plays right into the Bucks' hands. Is getting that rain for them. So, yeah, there could be a lot of late money on there. As I look right now across Vegas, I have one. That's it. Okay, two books that have it at 3.5. Just two. But again, I've seen a few other places that advertising, they're saying 3 or 3.5. Sorry.
It's starting to move, man. What's his name? That degenerate gambler put $3.5 million on Tampa Bay today.
Oh, the mattress guy. Yeah, I saw that too.
So that's already $6 million between him and the unknown person that put the 2.4 on them. So the big money's on Tampa Bay.
Yeah, but that's not – I don't know if that's sharp money or not. I don't know how that Mattress Mac guy does. He does okay. I don't know how. What I'd like to see his percentage numbers before I start throwing.
Actually, his percentages numbers suck dick, and I thought he was a mush. Where I wasn't even gonna bring that up, but like this guy's winning percentage, it hasn't been the best because he's been rooting against them leading up to this game. So you better eat a dick and not fuck this up.
Well, I got my buddy who bet in the Chiefs, so we've got that in our corner, man. That check is good as cash, I think. So.
Well, let's recap very quickly. Prop bets. Kev loves third quarter to outscore the first quarter. And if he can find second half to outscore the first half, he'll take that. He loves under 11.5 penalties and loves a touchdown under 1.5 yards. He will... Right. Take tails on the coin flip and Kelsey anytime TD. Dano loves Brady to throw a touchdown in the third quarter and in the fourth quarter. The jersey number of the first and last touchdown to be higher than 22.5. Third quarter more points than second quarter. And I love... Lowest scoring quarter being the first quarter. Roughing the passer, yes.
Yeah, love that.
And I'm going to play a first quarter draw. For the game,
that's what's up.
Kevin's hoping to go to the bank and then go to the steakhouse.
Well said.
Money line on Tampa Bay. Dano loves the money line on Tampa Bay. Kev also loves the first half under 28.5 points. I am going with the Kansas City money line just because.
How are you guys just feeling about this head. Over?
Will respect that more.
Boy, you know what? The over under is interesting to me because it has dropped. It opened at 57.5, which was ridiculously high. For a time yesterday, it was down to 55.5. It's at 56, so it's trending down. But then again, these are both two offenses that can just, you can have a 3-3 first quarter and still end up with 55 more points the rest of the game. You know what I mean? With these two teams. So I don't, I'm really torn about that over under. I don't know which way to lean on that one. You guys?
I'm waiting on the weather.
So
yeah,
if
that might be a day off choice.
Rain, take the under. Good, take the over.
It's under a pass for me. I don't have the balls to take the over because of that. If that's the case, it's going to be bad because it's usually a correlated parlay, dog and under, favorite and over. So I don't know if I'm going to go crazy with the under. If it rains, I'm in. If it doesn't rain, I'm very reluctant to take the whole game under. The first half under, I'm going to take no matter what. I just don't like that game under. For the exact reasons you just gave, where it just becomes fucking mad in 2021 and people start airing shit out and it's, they're just trading scores. I don't have the balls to do that because, again, I don't want to go over because that's not going to suit Tampa. Tampa's going to try and keep it on the ground, like I said, keep possession down, time to a minimum, and really do it that way. So I don't want to take over. I'm just going to go under if it's going to be really rainy. And that's it. Otherwise, I'll pass.
And I think these games have a tendency to start slowly because of the nerves. And, I'm not saying that, Tom Brady's going to be nervous or Patrick Mahomes is going to be nervous. But there are, but the vast majority of the people on both of those teams, their sphincters are going to be a little bit tight for the first possession, at least. Possession or two.
Not Tampa Bay.
So the weather right now, I'm looking at it. Thunderstorms in the morning, then cloudy late, high 73, winds very, very slight. Chance of rain 60%. Sunday night, Partly cloudy, 57 winds, light and variable, a 12% chance of rain.
Okay, so basically you're looking at the, well, when they say Sunday night, do they mean Sunday night or do they mean, you know, game time? Do they mean, you know, what's that game time? 6 o'clock Tampa?
6:30.
Yeah.
Sundown.
So it looks like it's not going to, it looks like weather may not be a factor.
No. Yeah, then I'm not, yeah, if that's the case, then I'm off of it.
Well, it should be interesting, fellas. Kevin, bring me back a doggy bag, will you?
Are you already surrendering that bet?
Bro, how about this? Why don't you double your bet and put it on the money line of Tampa Bay, and that way your little initial bet would be your hedge if KC were to win, which they won't. I just made your decision easier. But I respect you for holding tight and don't... you're gonna end up just rooting for your bets.
I mean, it's I mean, I'm going to
torturous for poor Al. We're just watching him squirm.
I am squirming.
He knows
dude.
We're right. He's trying to find his argument. And well, no, he's not but finding it, but it's definitely making his asshole pucker up.
Well, here's the thing: the only person who's been true to this the whole time has been Dano. Dano's been riding Tampa right. Bay since day one. You bet against them. All the way until now, I kept saying
I teased them against the Skins. I teased them against the Skins.
You teased them against the
against
Skins.
Them with the fucking,
you teased
the
them against the Skins. That means you weren't really positive about them. You teased
well,
them against
was I
the
right?
Skins.
Yeah, they didn't cover. Okay. They covered 8.5. I was right to do so.
I got you. And I had said earlier. I had been saying in the other shows, Tom Brady's got something to prove. Tom Brady's got something to prove. I didn't think they were going to make it out of Green Bay. I didn't think they were going to make it out of Green Bay at home, you know, and that showed me something. But then again, Green Bay played a really shitty game. And if Kansas City 2 weeks ago had played anywhere near the way they had been playing, because they had been winning games by like 3, 5, 6, they hadn't been covering. And then 2 weeks ago, they went, okay, time to get serious, boys. And they just steamrolled the Bills. Had they not steamrolled the Bills, I'd be taking Tampa Bay in the 3. But I can't discount the Chiefs as much as you can't discount Brady.
I just had a premonition, Kev. I kind of have that gut instinct that Sue lands on Pat Mahomes and he might be taken out of the game in the second quarter. I'm having that Lamar Jackson feeling about this game.
Really?
Wow.
How you feel about that, Rock?
Wow.
Wow.
And there's our roughing the passer, too.
And there's a roughing the passer. Oh, my God.
Yeah, I'll win on that one.
That's the thing, man, between the prop bets and every other, all the type of bets that we got going. If we can come out ahead, we'll be in good shape.
Hey, Kev, how'd your event go?
It went great, man. Everything went fantastic. Give it a listen. It's the newest episode, Gutting the Sacred Cow. We did the Karate Kid. I really couldn't have asked. Everything went swimmingly. The only thing that sucked was a few people that week got COVID and couldn't show up. So a few of our fans, unfortunately, got sick. But we still had a great turnout, especially during the middle of a pandemic. But, yeah, it went great. We had a great episode. And you can hear it all on guttingthesacredcow.com, all the different podcast platforms, iTunes, Google, iHeartRadio, Spotify, Spreaker, Stitcher, you name it. We're there. Give it a listen. And while you're there, give it a 5-star rating, 2-sentence, 3-sentence review.
Nice lead into the outro for you, huh, Ro?
Absolutely. So, when you listen to it, yeah, make sure you give it a review. Give it 5 stars. Absolutely. Tell a friend. Dano, anything you want to hit?
Signal the launch. Instagram, our website. Check out some live music, some recorded music, classic rock, hard rock. Check it out.
Nice. Nice. Me, AlRokerJr.com, at Al Roker Jr., Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, also on Twitter, at Roker Radio. Fellas, this has been a blast. It kind of, these 5 weeks of the playoffs have kind of, you know, just flown by. I've really had fun with you guys and Kevin, we got to make sure that we, you know, we don't do this just, you know, every 12 months or so. Because I know that you're going to have shit on your mind.
This is always a blast to do.
Yeah, we're gonna need to get together a couple of times during the year and shoot the shit. How about we make a
sure.
plan to do that?
Love to. Absolutely love to.
All right, fellas, good luck. Have a good Super Bowl Sunday. Hopefully we can all make some money. And yes, don't worry, I will hedge my bet. So that we'll
we broke them, Dano. We broke them.
I will.
Bro, you know that it's all about it's how you started it. If you had said that you were putting that loot on KC, he would have been so fucking happy.
I know. Oh, I know. I took the tits right out of him, and
you
that
crushed
email,
him.
Yeah. Dude, I thought Green Bay was going to go all the way.
That's cool.
I thought it was going to be Green Bay. That Green Bay game really.
That
would
have been a challenge. We'd be picking that one because that shit really, you could flip a fucking coin.
I would have went with Mahomes all the way just for him winning me money in week two. I would have been like, all right, I'm riding all the way with him if it was him against Green Bay.
Well, we shall see. Super Bowl 55 on Sunday. Everybody, put some skin in the game. Whether or not you join one of these betting apps and you do it that way, or you get in on the office squares or something like that, you'll enjoy the game much more if you have a little skin in it. Fellas, thank you for all these times over these last few weeks. I appreciate it. Be safe.
Thank you.
Everyone listening, please, also you guys, be safe, wear a mask, do the right thing, and I'll talk to you next time. Peace.